for the most part, there's only three fertilizers you need to be successful in a backyard garden. Those are... What's up, Lazy Dog fam? I hope everybody out there is having an amazing day. It is Tuesday, November 29th. We got a beautiful day here in South Georgia. Supposed to get some pretty bad weather tonight. They're talking about some tornadoes could spring up, so that's not good. We got a few things we need to do in the garden today. First of all, I want to take you through a little update on our in-ground brassica plot here. Got a lot of good looking stuff here behind me, show you all that. Then we need to tend to our Brussels sprouts a little bit, talk about growing Brussels sprouts, and then later in the video I'm going to tell you the three basic fertilizers that any gardener needs. So here we've got one of our three in-ground no-till plots full of just some absolutely beautiful brassicas. A lot of good groceries going to end up coming out of this plot. Let's start over here on this end where we have some broccoli. These may be some of the biggest broccoli plants I have ever had. They're just huge. And I noticed the other day, starting to get a little head formation on these. Let me see if I can find one here. There we go. Still a long ways to go, but always good to see that. Now, I'm no professional broccoli farmer, but it has been my experiences over the years that the larger the broccoli plant you can grow, the larger the head you're going to get. So you really got to feed that broccoli well early on. And we're going to talk more about fertilization later in the video, but you want to make sure your broccoli plants are nice and big and healthy. If the plants are small, they'll likely start producing heads early, and those heads might not be quite as large as you want. So you want bigger plants, dark green leaves, really important to get them some nutrients early on, make a nice big dense plant, and then you'll get a nice big head of broccoli. Now, although these two rows look pretty much the same, we do have two different varieties here. So we've got Green Magic in this row, and then we've got Imperial in that row. Both of these varieties always seem to do well for us. It started out with the Imperial kind of outpacing the Green Magic as far as plant growth goes, but it seems like the Green Magic has caught up to the Imperial. As you can see, these kind of look the same. No real noticeable differences between the plants here. Maybe the Imperial is just a hair bit taller, but I expect some good production out of both of these rows. And you'll notice as we move along here, very, very little pest damage in this plot. And I haven't sprayed them a lot. I only sprayed them that one time with Azera. We did that, I don't know, it's been maybe 3 or 4 weeks ago on a video. So just one treatment with Azera seems to have controlled any pest problems that we were going to have here. And as I told you in that video, that's why I like the Azera, because I don't have to spray it near as often as something like BT or some other organic insecticides. And then moving along to the right of that broccoli, we've got our cauliflower here. I believe this variety is called Amazing. This is a white cauliflower variety. We grew it last year. Did well for us. Starting to see the leaves wrap a little bit down in there, but still a decent ways from having any head formation. So we'll just keep a close eye on these. May take some rubber bands and wrap up the tops there once we do start getting some head formation. Right now, we're just trying to keep these plants looking green and healthy. Then we've got two rows of Brussels sprouts here, which are looking nice as well. We're going to deal with these a little more in a minute. But one thing to note here, I don't know how well you can tell this on camera, but at the beginning of this row right here, about a third of the way down the row, these plants here look smaller and not quite as good as all the rest of the plants in that row and in this row. And that's because we've got two different varieties here. So this is a variety called Gladius that we planted last year, had a few seeds left over. And then this is a variety called Dagon that I've never grown before, but heard really good things about. And then lastly, as far as the cool season stuff in this plot goes, we've got our two rows of cabbage here. This row, we've got the Megaton variety. I'm going to try my best to grow a 20-pound cabbage just to say I've done it. And I don't know if we're going to get a 20-pounder from every single head here. Some of these look a little better than others. That one there looks like we might have a chance at a 20-pound head. Some of these others might be more closer to 10 or 15 pounds. Going to be good eating regardless, but I would like to grow at least one monster there. In the next row, we've got two different varieties. We've got the Bravo and then Capture on the end there. Been really, really impressed with Bravo so far. This is definitely a keeper in my opinion. Even though it hasn't made heads yet, we haven't even eaten any of it yet. But just the way it grows, just been a nice looking cabbage variety for us. The Capture isn't bad. We grew the Capture last year and liked it. Got some nice looking plants there, but I'm leaning a little more toward Bravo as my new go-to cabbage variety. So I couldn't be happier with how all that stuff is doing. Now I know it may look like we've just poured the fertilizer to that stuff, but I promise you we haven't. We've only fed it just a few times, but these no-till plots, as has been my experiences with them, if you can just get the transplants to survive the transplanting and rooting process, man, they'll really, really take off and just look nice and healthy because we've got all that good biology in the soil. Now, as promised, let's talk a little bit more about our Brussels sprouts here. So I don't always have success with Brussels sprouts, and I think it has a lot to do with where we live. There's a lot of produce growing around our area here in South Georgia. I've never seen any of these farmers growing Brussels sprouts, so it's probably a good reason why. We still try to grow them every year, and we're somewhat successful every now and then, but it's not something I can count on every single year. I have been successful the last 2 years in a row, which has me worried a little bit about this year. But these plants are looking really good so far, so I'm hopeful maybe I can string a little run together there. If I can get 3 good years of Brussels sprouts in a row, man, I feel like I will have accomplished something. Now last year we tried something I had never tried before on Brussels sprouts. I think I saw this on Hollis and Nancy's channel a while back. But anyway, we came in here and pruned some of these bottom limbs on these Brussels sprout plants in the hopes that that would encourage more uniform sprout development there along the stalk, maybe make the stalks a little taller. Seemed like it helped last year, but I didn't really do a side-by-side comparison with plants I didn't prune versus plants I did prune. Now, in researching online tips for growing Brussels sprouts, I didn't find a lot of information that said pruning these bottom limbs here is going to give you a significantly more production. What I did find was several sources that said you do want to trim some of the very bottom ones, keep the leaves off the ground, that'll keep you from getting some disease in the stalks there. That makes sense. Also saw a couple sources that said, yeah, prune them, but just a little bit, only about a third of those leaves. So just about a third the way up the stalk there. Don't try to prune the whole thing because it'll stress the plant and end up hurting your production in the long run. Now there did seem to be somewhat of a consensus online as far as topping the plants when they get real close to being ready to harvest, to basically cut out the top of the plant, and that's going to encourage more uniform sprout development along the stalk there. Like I said, I didn't find a whole lot as far as pruning those side leaves. So I think this would be a great time to do a little experiment, and since we have two rows of Brussels sprout plants here, should be nice. So what we're going to do here is just leave this row alone as it is, let it be, just see what happens there. And over here on this row, we're going to prune some of these bottom limbs off here. I'm not going to get more than a third of them, but we're going to get some of them off the bottom there. Now we do have a different variety here than we have right here. Like I said, this is Gladius. This is a variety called Dagon. But in the back half of this row, we have Dagon planted as well. So while it may not be apples to apples right here because we have two different varieties towards the back of this row, we do have the same variety planted so we can do a direct comparison. Let's take our handy Felco pruners here and we're just gonna chop and drop. Not get all of them, just some of those on the bottom there. And as I cut these, I'm gonna kind of rake them with my hand towards the center of the row there, give me some nice in row weed suppression. Let's see there. We'll get one more right there, maybe one more right there, and that'll be good. Just get those that have the potential to be touching the ground or ones that are touching the ground already. All right, now I may have taken a little closer to 2/3 of the leaves on some of these stalks, like those two right there, but it'll be all right. We at least got those bottom ones off the ground, which is what we're going for. Now, like I told you earlier, I'm very due to get skunked on Brussels sprouts. Had 2 years in a row where we did all right. I'm due for skunking on these, but let's just keep our fingers crossed that we can maybe get some conclusive results out of here that will tell us something about how we should manage our Brussels sprouts in the future. Now, one last thing I want to do to these Brussels sprouts, although they look nice and green and healthy now, is side dress them one more time. Now, I don't have any real empirical data to back this up, but in past years, my Brussels sprout plants haven't looked as good as these have. They weren't all nice and lush and with dark, shiny green leaves. So I think maybe I haven't been feeding them enough, and that's why we're gonna give them one more shot. Now, if you follow the channel, you already know that you're supposed to carry your fertilizer out to the garden in a dog's bucket. You can see what it's done for my garden there. So we got some Nature Safe 1300 in there. Gonna put about a scoop and a half alongside each row there. Gonna do this on both rows, and then we'll scratch it in a little bit with a hoe. All right, so we got those side dress, got that mixed into the soil a little bit there. Hopefully we get some rain tonight, help start dissolving some of that, activating some of that organic fertilizer. Still a ways to go on these Brussels sprouts, and I'm hoping that side dressing there helps keep them nice, green, and healthy through the duration of their growth cycle. So now that we've got our garden work done for the day, let's talk a little bit about different types of fertilizers to use in your garden. We get a lot of questions from time to time, people asking, well, what do I need to fertilize this with? What do I need to fertilize this with? When do I need to fertilize this? How often should I fertilize this? And I think sometimes, maybe, I'm guilty myself, we make this more complicated than it has to be. Now, some of you out there are blessed with very nutritious soils, really nutrient-dense soils, and you don't have to fertilize that much. Some of us down here have really sandy soils that don't hold nutrients very well, and we have to fertilize a little bit more. But I want to give you kind of a basic plan, just a basic regime that should help any gardener out there as far as what they need to be feeding their plants. And before we get into this, I should mention all three of these fertilizers that I'm going to use as examples are organic. Now, I haven't always been strictly organic about my fertilization, and I'm not one to get on a pedestal and preach to people about how they should use only organic fertilizers. You use whatever works for you, whatever you've got access to, whatever your budget allows for. Now, we have seen quite a difference in our soil health since we transitioned to mostly organic fertilizers. But I'm not here to tell you what you should be putting in your garden. Put whatever you feel comfortable using or whatever your budget dictates that you should be using. Now, we do use some real specialized fertilizers on certain specific rare occasions. For the most part, there's only three fertilizers you need to be successful in a backyard garden. Those are a balanced granular fertilizer, a balanced liquid fertilizer, and then a nitrogen fertilizer. Now, for my examples, I'll be showing the stuff that we use in our gardens. You can use whatever brand you have available to you. Sometimes this Nature Safe stuff right here isn't easy to find, but this is not about necessarily the brand of fertilizer, more just the type of fertilizer and how you use it. So this Nature Safe 855 is the granular balanced or somewhat balanced fertilizer we use in the planting furrow with every single thing we plant around here, maybe with the exception of okra. Try not to give okra too many nutrients. But pretty much everything we grow, we put a balanced granular fertilizer in the furrow before we plant it. And I think that's a great idea. That'll go a long way to helping you be successful in the garden. And if you're not trying to hit an absolute home run with some plants, sometimes just having a little bit of this in the planting furrow might be enough to carry them all the way to the finish. But I'd highly recommend always putting a balanced granular fertilizer in the furrow at planting. And then we like to have a somewhat balanced liquid fertilizer to feed our plants as they grow and to also feed our soil. And we like to have something liquid on hand just because it's really easy to apply. We can inject it through the drip system. We can inject it through our overhead sprinkler. We can inject it through a watering wine. We can put some in a 5-gallon bucket, mix it up, take a little pitcher, pour it alongside the plants. Just really, really easy to apply this liquid stuff here. Now the analysis on this AgriThrive is 3-3-2, so it's not completely balanced, but it's close enough. And then the last basic fertilizer I think everybody needs to have is just a straight nitrogen source. Now, there are some plants we grow in the vegetable garden that like a lot of nitrogen, things like corn, onions, garlic, even this cabbage here behind me, which we've side dressed with this stuff here already. So those things need proportionately more nitrogen than they do phosphorus and potassium. That's where having a strictly nitrogen fertilizer comes into play there. We can give those plants what they need as they grow. So we use mostly the NatureSafe 1300 as our nitrogen fertilizer, but as we do more grazing with the chickens, I foresee us having to use less and less of this because those chickens are putting down a significant amount of nitrogen as well. So if you have a good manure input, you know, cleaning out a chicken house, you got rabbit pens, horse manure, cow manure, whatever, then there's your nitrogen fertilizer. You don't have to buy any. But if you don't have a good nitrogen source sustainably around your farm or homestead, then having a strictly nitrogen fertilizer on hand can be helpful in the backyard garden. So that's basically it. It's really not that complicated. Give your plant something balanced, granular, in the furrow at planting. Feed them a couple times throughout their life with some liquid balanced fertilizer. And if they're one of those heavy feeding crops, give them some extra nitrogen. You don't have to overcomplicate things. If you have really, really nutrient dense soils, you might not have to do it as much as we do down here. But keeping those three types of fertilizers on hand, whatever the brand might be, whatever the analysis might be, go a long way to helping you be successful growing your own food. So I hope you enjoyed the video today. Nice to get a little work done in that plot behind me. Nice to get that little experiment on the Brussels sprouts going. And let me know in the comments below what you think about our little experiment here. Do you think we're going to see any considerable differences between those two rows? Or you think they're probably going to be about the same? And also let me know what you think about my kind of simplified fertilizer plan there. You agree, disagree with it? And also let me know what your inputs are. What are your main go-to fertilizers that you use all the time in your garden? And as always, we'll put links in the description below to any of the products we talked about or used in this video. You can also find links to all our affiliate partners. Got some coupon codes for some of those companies so you can take advantage of those discounts. Don't forget to go check out our website, lazydogfarm.com, where we've got our garden blog, recipes, hats, shirts, all kind of good stuff over there. If you did enjoy the video, be sure to subscribe, hit that notification button, like, and share. And we'll see you next time right here at Lazy Dog Farm.
Oh, farewell. By the beauty of your life.